I wanted to start us on time so that we were on schedule at least once today. And so here we are. We do have a busy day. I hope it'll be an important day for you. It's the first of several orientation sessions that we have planned throughout the year. Instead of giving you everything in a sort of core dump up front, we decided to try to meter things out and make it a more manageable amount of information and time things according to the flow of the academic year a little bit. So stay tuned for additional experiences. Today, we're hoping to accomplish several things. One is to give you the opportunity to meet some people who I hope will be very helpful to you during your careers here. Another will be to talk about some things that we also hope will be helpful as you start your long and successful careers at the University of Oregon. We're going to take advantage after lunch to at least give you the opportunity to have a formal tour of campus brought around by our campus ambassadors. The most remarkable campus I've been on, I don't know how many you've explored, but it's just the best, and my children cursed me when they had to go away to go to school because they had spent their lives on this campus and it was time to go somewhere else. But we're the best. So take advantage and see some of the campus. And finally, we're going to continue what you've already started, and that is, I hope, give you a beginning of a sense of community and belonging as a duck in this crazy little town called Eugene. So regarding community, let me start with just a little community building exercise and awareness, if we can. I'm gonna ask for hands. This is orientation for new faculty and officers of administration. How many new officers of administration are here? Whole bunch. It's, all of you, as you're here, you'll recognize officer of administration is a term we use, but it covers an incredible amount of territory. It's not just the folks that you think of as administrators, but it's all sorts of people doing all sorts of things. How many are new faculty then? And just for fun, we have these groups of faculty. We're all faculty, but we have tenure-related and non-tenure-related. How many tenure-related faculty are here? And non-tenure-related. So we're about even mixes of OAs, TTF, and TTF. There's some acronyms for you. How many of you are from Oregon? Not very many. How many from the Pacific Northwest? Should be a few more. How many from west of the Mississippi? Wow, you guys are in trouble. No, east of the Mississippi? That's interesting to me. And because if you're from outside the U.S., you're not sure which way you should count. How many from outside the United States? Quite a few. Cool. We have a world community right here. How long have you been here? How many of you have been in Eugene for more than 2 months? How many for like a month? Less than a month? Couple days? Really? It's okay, it doesn't take long. And last, how many of you are worried about the rain? No. It's only two. Come talk to me. I came here from Los Angeles a long, long time ago, and I really thought it was going to be a problem. And I love it. You'll see why in December and January when the annuals are still blooming and the daffodils come up in February. All right, a few logistics before we jump into the programming. I think you all found sign-in sheets and name tags on your tables. If not, please do sign in. And if you didn't run out of name tags, make a name tag for yourself. And if you did sign or run out of name tags, or if you need parking validation, if you somehow found your way into a parking lot nearby here, talk to Sonia Runberg, who I will introduce to you later, but she's out near the front door right now. Feel free to stand up. You're a little packed in here tightly, although this room is meant to be an active learning sort of space. There are aisles for you to get out. There's breakfast will stay there. The coffee is in carafes, but also in the back, and there actually is a real regular coffee in the back now, too. Restrooms are on each floor, and behind, kind of straight across the hall, if you see the elevator, go just to the right of the elevator, and you'll find your way. All right, with that, let me start by telling you that I wish I were introducing our president or our provost. Unfortunately, neither of them can be here today. Our provost travel plans allowing, we'll be here this evening back in this room for our social hour starting at 5:30 and then the dinner. So please do come back for that, and Scott Coltrane will be making some remarks then. You'll have lots of other opportunities throughout your careers here and throughout the coming year in particular to meet the president and the provost. Take advantage. They, as all of us in the administration, I believe, have no greater joy than getting to know the people who work here. So take advantage and let them get to know you. The president, for example, has started a collection of faculty books. And he's invited faculty who have published a book to come in and visit with him and talk about the book and leave their desk copy with him. But it's the best part of what we do in the administration is work with the faculty and staff and, of course, the students. Let me start the session then by introducing the Senior Vice Provost for Academic Affairs. We have Doug Blandy, who is Professor of Arts and Administration, as well as Senior Vice Provost, and Susan Anderson, who is Professor of German, as well as Senior Vice Provost.
Thank you, Ken, and thanks to all of those who helped make this event possible. It's a pleasure to be here with you this morning and throughout the day. As you heard Ken say, Scott Coltrane is not being able to be with us here this morning, but he does send his greetings. He is attending a meeting of the provost of the American Association of University, and again, he hopes to be here for dinner. But he wanted me to convey to you that this is a very fortuitous time to be joining the University of Oregon. We are enjoying some extraordinary momentum in moving the institution forward. And in part, this is motivated by the arrival of our 18th president, Michael Schill. You are joining us at a time when we are moving forward on goals that are going to be extremely important to who we are and some strategic initiatives who will help shape and inform this institution for many years to come. We are in the midst of attracting bright, high-achieving, and diverse students. We are hiring more outstanding and diverse faculty members, as we see here today. We're providing more opportunities for Oregon students who have financial needs so that they can attend the University of Oregon. And in a meeting earlier this week, Michael Schill reinforced the importance of access at the University of Oregon. We are supporting all students' success with increased support and enrichment. This includes joining what's called the Student Success Collaborative, which is offered through the Educational Advisory Board that will allow all of us to be smarter as we advise our students. We're creating and maintaining spaces, resources, and technology needed for our faculty and also for our students to be able to learn. And we're ensuring our own financial stability and being responsible around our budgets. Strategic initiatives include increasing our scholarships for top scholars. We're anticipating that our honors college will grow significantly, and we look forward to expanding our PhD fellowships. And most importantly, we're entering a time where we're anticipating increasing our numbers of faculty beyond the numbers here now by 10 to 15 over the next 5 years. So as you see, this is a great time to be here at the University of Oregon. This is my 28th year. It's been a great place to make a career, and I think you'll find that for yourselves as well.
So I'd like to welcome you all as well and let you know a little bit about the Office of Academic Affairs with which you'll probably interact in some way already in your first year and definitely throughout your time here. So the mission or the goals of the Academic Affairs Office are, for one thing, to promote and sustain the highest standards in teaching, research, and service, and to foster faculty excellence and achievement through such things as membership on committees, on important committees, curriculum oversight, the whole promotion and tenure process which we oversee, various workshops on issues related to your research and your teaching and your other work, and just being available to help you with questions you may have. We also obviously promote a respectful work environment. We work collaboratively with the Office of Inclusion and Equity, and we definitely promote a family-friendly workplace. We support and coordinate matters that pertain to faculty and academics, and that includes hiring, retention, and as I mentioned already, the promotion and tenure processes. So all the contracts for the academic-related faculty go through our office. And not last but not least, we advance university outreach to the local community, to the region, to the country, and globally. So that's just a little bit to help you situate our office and how it can help you.
And as Susan has described, we're a very service-friendly office and organization. We have just recently updated our website after a year of study, including meeting with multiple focus groups. If you go to academicaffairs.uoregon.edu, you will find many, many resources that will help you thrive here. You will see three portals, one for tenure track faculty, one for non-tenure track faculty, and a primary interest to you today, including the OAs, a portal for new hires. One of the things that you will also find there is the University of Oregon Faculty Handbook. This handbook is a result of our collaboration with United Academics, and it's a highly interactive and informative handbook that should provide you with all the information that you need. However, as Susan has pointed out, you know, if there are things that you can't find, then please call the office and we can point you in the right direction or answer your questions, or you can also email us as well. So as I said earlier, I've been here 28 years. I'm a professor in the Arts Administration program. That's primarily a graduate program that prepares students to be leaders in the arts and cultural sector. As you engage in the arts and culture in Eugene, Oregon, and the region, virtually every place that you will engage with has probably had students from the Arts Administration program involved with it, either as interns and/or they may be leadership currently. My own research is in the area of community arts, and I teach in the area of community arts. My primary research interests right now are in China, working collaboratively with scholars there, which is informed by work on a website, primarily through a website and an open access archive, which provides interpretive materials related to China's traditional culture. My responsibilities in academic affairs are primarily associated with tenure track faculty. I work very closely with my colleagues there, particularly Ken Doxey, in being sure that our tenure and promotion materials as they come into the office are in the best shape that they can possibly be so that people are fairly evaluated, and then being sure that they're prepared for ultimately the provost's review and decision making. In addition to that, I also work very closely with United Academics on the implementation of our collective bargaining agreements. Our first contract is ending. We're in the midst of ratification of a new 3-year contract, which is very good news for the institution, and also speaks to the good relationship that the university has with United Academics. It's also my great pleasure to be able to work with other units on campus, such as the Jordan Schnitzer Museum of Art, the Museum of Natural and Cultural History, the Oregon Bach Festival, the Wayne Moore Center, and the Labor Education and Research Center. All of these offer public programs, and I encourage you to watch for what their offerings are and take advantage of those.
The Office of Academic Affairs oversees a great many issues, and I've only been in the job for 2 months, and I'm still learning about all the many things that we do, but there's so much that there are two senior vice provosts, and we have different duties, although we work a lot together on many things. And Doug's primarily focused on tenure-related faculty issues, and my work is mainly with non-tenure related faculty. So all faculty and teaching faculty and research faculty who are not on the tenure track will be connected in one way or another to my office. But before I talk about that, I wanted to say a little bit about myself. I'm a professor of German literature. I've been also at the university for many years. My areas now are late 20th to the literature to the present, and I particularly focus on questions of what it means to be German and what it means to be foreign. And this is a huge question in the changing society of Germany today, which is a culture that thinks of itself still as homogenous, when in reality it is very, very diverse. And I'm curious and interested in the different ways that artists and writers and film directors try to help Germans rethink what it means to be belonging or not belonging, foreign or not foreign. So that's my research area. But in the Office of Academic Affairs, I will help with the promotion of non-tenure track faculty from there are different levels that you can go up to. So we have a promotion review that goes on every year, also classifying people from one classification or rank to another. That goes through our office, and the hiring, all the hiring documents as well. I work on a number of committees, including the Undergraduate Council and the Graduate Council. I'm also involved with the Implementation Committee of the Collective Bargaining Agreement, and I work with the the Vice Provost of International Affairs and the Vice Provost for Undergraduate Studies on the many and myriad initiatives they undertake, as well as with the Director of the Center for Latin American Studies. So that just gives you a little bit of an idea of my background, and I look forward to getting to know all of you as the years progress.
Again, thanks very much for being here, and both Susan and I look forward to our paths crossing with yours over today and over the coming weeks and over this academic term. So, thank you.
And because you're new and you probably haven't, you obviously haven't met people from all across the campus, maybe you haven't even met the dean of your own college or school, we wanted to give you a little bit of an introduction to some of the academic leaders on this campus in video format. So we've created a video, it's just a short video of welcome from some of the deans, from some of the vice provosts, and from the provost. So I would like to thank Gretchen Drew in our Office of Academic Affairs and Charlie Litchfield in Digital Communications for making this video.
Welcome. I'm Scott Coltrane. I'm the Senior Vice President and Provost. And as Chief Academic Officer, I'm really glad you're here.
Hi, I'm Julie Newton, Interim Edwin L. Arts Dean of the School of Journalism and Communication.
I'm Scott Pratt, Dean of the Graduate School.
My name is Randy Camphouse, and I have the honor of serving as Dean of the College of Education.
I'm Andrew Marcus, Interim Dean of the College of Arts and Sciences.
Hi, I'm Jim Terborg, Interim Dean of the Lundquist College of Business.
My name is Michael Moffitt. I'm the Dean of the Law School.
My name is Adrian Lim. I'm Dean of Libraries and Philip H. Knight Chair.
I'm Brooke Muller, Interim Dean of the School of Architecture and Allied Arts.
My name is Brad Foley, and I have the pleasure of serving as Dean of the School of Music and Dance.
My name's Terry Hunt. I'm Dean of the Clark Honors College.
Welcome.
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 Welcome to the University of Oregon.
Serving the state, nation, and world since 1876.
The University of Oregon
is a comprehensive
public research university
committed to exceptional teaching,
discovery,
and service.
We work at a human scale
to generate big ideas.
As a community of scholars,
we help individuals question critically,
think logically,
reason effectively,
communicate clearly,
act creatively,
and live ethically.
We're a great university. It's a place where faculty really discover new knowledge, and you're part of that.
Education isn't simply about particular events in a classroom, isn't simply about a particular experience or encounter here, but it's about the way in which we fold all of those particular moments together in our life story.
Our faculty represent the conduit to the community, whether it's through the presentation of artistic performances or dance, or presentations of more academic nature, ranging from nanotechnology to philosophy. We bring the expertise of our faculty to the benefit of our community.
I've been at the University of Oregon since 1987, and I have never been more optimistic about the future of this institution. We have extraordinary students, distinguished and productive faculty, and strong leadership. All of those factors are coming together to make this a place where people can thrive.
I'm inspired by all the faculty, staff, students who work, learn, explore, and teach here. We want to do all we can to support their passions and aspirations.
They can not only dip into a law firm or dip into a place of business for a few hours, but actually come and be here and spend really quality time in any of those places to really get a full education, bring what they learn in on those settings back into the classroom, and then what they learn in the classroom back into the setting.
I see our ability to grow as a research university and become one of the top research universities in the United States. At the same time, I can see us increasing and improving our ability to teach our students and to help them learn more about the society we live in and impart not just knowledge, but help them find wisdom.
And what that means is pursuing faculty who are excellent in every way. It means pursuing faculty who bring different experiences, different research methodologies, different ways of thinking into the classroom. It means that ensuring that our diverse students who come from a variety of different backgrounds, experiences, and ideologies feel welcome and at home in the classroom. And it means ensuring that we put in place all of the resources necessary to make sure that when people think about ideologies and a diversity of how it is that we think about research, they think about the University of Oregon.
So it's really important for us as a community to embrace diversity, to embrace difference, and certainly one very important way to do that is to welcome the world to this little town.
There's something about being embedded in this incredible natural beauty and a sense of the stewardship that inspires for our future on this planet. I've been here 20 years and I never want to leave.
I kind of want to clap because Gretchen and Charlie did a really good job at that and worked really hard. Some folks that screened that video commented that there are scenes where you only see a single student walking through campus, and is that the spirit we want to get? And I was thinking about that as I watched it today, and I like that sense because I mentioned I came from LA, a place where if you said, you know, I want to get away from the city, I'm gonna go to the mountains. It typically only took a few hours to get there. Or you went to the beach and found that everybody else went there too, so you should have stayed home. Eugene is the second or third, depending who's counting, the largest city in the state. And if you want to get away from it all, you can drive a few minutes. Or you can bicycle across the bridge over to Autzen Stadium and be in the middle of the forest. Or you can be on campus and find a quiet place. It'll be less quiet starting tomorrow. We'll talk about that later. But it's a place where the natural beauty that you see really comes to us right here on campus as well. So when I started as an assistant professor a few centuries ago, I really didn't know much about governance or structure or state systems or anything. That said, I think there's a reasonable chance that all of you have at least heard something about the fact that governance structures have changed in the state of Oregon. We've transitioned from a state board of higher education to local independent governing boards, for example. That's been reasonably visible in the national media and international. It's been impactful in terms of changing the way we will work here, and you'll hear about that through your coming years, I'm certain. And to introduce a little bit of that topic, we have the pleasure of having Angela Wilhelms, who's the Secretary of the University of Oregon, who will welcome you and on behalf of the Board of Trustees and talk with you a little bit about that structure. Angela.
Good morning. Thank you all for being here today. It was a year ago that I was in your seats. And more importantly, thank you for joining the University of Oregon community. My first year here has been extraordinary because I really had no idea what a sense of community this place had. I had no idea of the depth of the service that the university brought to its students and to the state and the world. And I'm embarrassed by that fact because I've lived in Oregon almost my entire life. But I'm inspired every day, coming from a non-academic background, to see the work that the staff and the faculty together do to support the students and to support research and the community and our future through that research. So this morning, I wanted to first send a very hearty welcome from our board chair, Chuck Lillis. Chuck was unable to be here today, but wanted to welcome you all. He got his PhD from the University of Oregon a few years ago, which is, we don't get into the details of numbers, and that's probably going to put me in jeopardy of my job. But ever since then, Chuck has maintained a passion for the institution and its faculty and staff, and so he wanted me to relay to you his gratitude for you joining the university and how much he looks forward to the opportunity to meet with you and interact with you here on campus. I also have been asked to share a welcome from the president, who is today celebrating Yom Kippur, and wanted to extend his deepest gratitude. He is first and foremost, if you ask him, a member of the faculty at this university. He is a professor of law. And he has been here 3 months almost. We round up a little bit when it's convenient. And he wishes he could be here today, but looks forward to meeting you all. One of the most inspiring things about his start here at the university is the time that he's dedicating to getting out and about on the campus and the satellite offices to meet people and connect. So I have no doubt that you will have the opportunity to interact with him very soon, but he sends his best wishes. So I will give you just a few minutes of overview. If you haven't already, you will no doubt over the course of your first year or two here, hear a little bit about governance transition at the University of Oregon. The university was part of a statewide system of 7 public institutions up until July 1 of last year. And at that time, a piece of legislation took effect that gave the University of Oregon and Portland State University their own independent governing boards, and gave the other 5 institutions the opportunity to establish an independent board as well. All 5 took advantage of that, and so as of July 1 this year, all 7 institutions are governed by an independent board, and the state system no longer exists, literally. So there are a number of things that come with that that are exciting, challenging, that fill this place with opportunity. Not the least of them is the actual board itself. You can get information on the board at its website. So if you just Google, that's probably the easiest. If you're good at remembering URLs, it's trustees@uoregon.edu. The governing board has 15 members. One of those is the president as an ex officio non-voting member. 3 of them are from the campus. And so pay attention, because if you're ever interested in this, you have the opportunity. One of them is a faculty member, one of them is a student, and one of them is a non-faculty staff member at the university. And it was very important and put into the legislation that those 3 positions exist. So, again, as you get grounded here, if you ever have an interest, feel free to reach out. And then there are 11 at-large positions, and they represent alumni and business leaders and civic leaders and community leaders and lawyers and construction workers and finance experts and a whole host of broad-based experience that we believe is really helping the university and the university leadership focus on a few key priorities. The priorities for the board are fairly simple and fairly complex all at once. They're simple in the sense that it's basically access, excellence, and financial stability for the long-term future of the institution. So, you know, it's not very many words, it's pretty easy to remember. But those are complex issues that the board wrestles with day in and day out. And the board itself has delegated much of its management authority to the president of the institution, who in turn has a team of vice presidents and other administrators that you'll meet today to actually execute the administration of the university. Our governing board has made it very clear and will continue to do so that they are there to govern, there to help guide the institution, but they aren't experts at running a university on a day-to-day basis. They're volunteers, so they all have other careers outside of their service to the university. So you will see them for their quarterly meetings. They come off cycle for other meetings and educational opportunities. But much of the work then is actually delegated through the board to the administration and the president. The presidency is one of the foremost responsibilities of the governing board, and so they're very pleased that they were able to bring the 18th president of the university to Eugene, and we're very excited about him as he gets started. Just a couple of quick administrative notes to, you will get over your time here a lot of email, a lot of updates, and a lot of information. You will, on occasion, get emails from the Board of Trustees, and I encourage you to look at those. They don't do it very often. We try to respect that. You have work to do, and you don't need to know every little nuance that they're doing. But there's a couple things I want to specifically point out, and one is that the board has made a commitment to, during its quarterly meetings, to hosting discussion group sessions where 2 to 3 of the trustees will get together with, you know, about 10 seems to be the right size, individuals from the campus community. And so we break those up. Sometimes they're faculty focused, sometimes they're staff focused, sometimes they're student focused. But you'll have an opportunity to sign up for those. So if the university, its governance, its long-term, you know, future, any of those topics are of interest to you, or if you just want to come and ask a trustee what the heck do they do, that's an opportunity that you'll have. So I encourage you when you get those invitations to sign up. The other thing, your faculty trustee, Susan Gary, so I know not all of you are faculty, so I'm speaking to you now. Susan Gary is a professor of law, and she has indicated that this year, so she's working on her schedule right now, she's going to host a series of office hours so that faculty members, or frankly anyone from the community, who want to come and talk with her about her role on the board or issues that they're facing can do so in a smaller group setting or even one-on-one if that is available to you too. So we'll be getting that information out to you, and if you ever have any questions, you can go to our website. All of our contact information is on there. But mostly I just want to, on behalf of the board and the president, say thank you very much for joining the university community. We look forward to working with you, and I think you're going to be very, very happy here.
Thank you, Angela. This is indeed a board that is accessible. So if you want to be involved, if you want to meet them, the opportunity is there. Their sessions are, except when they have to be closed or open to general audience. During coffee breaks, they don't disappear. You can ask them questions, you can talk to them, you can express opinions, so take advantage. University of Oregon is a research university, very high research activity, Carnegie classification, R1, depending what terminology you like to use. I might add that I think we're a university that does a good job of understanding what research looks like. At a comprehensive university like this, we embrace the notions of scholarship, of creative expression, of artistic practice, and so on. To discuss more about the research mission of the university, I'm pleased to introduce Brad Shelton, professor of mathematics and interim vice president for research.
Thank you, Ken. Well, on behalf of myself and the president, and the provost, who are both quite unhappy that they couldn't be here this morning, welcome to the University of Oregon. It's interesting, I remember sitting in my orientation as a new faculty member just over 30 years ago. One of the striking differences is that the only people who were in the room were tenure-related faculty. Everybody else was ignored. We've come a long way since then. We've really come a long way towards recognizing the importance of our non-tenure track faculty, the professional instruction that's provided, the professional research that's provided, and the incredible contribution of our officers of administration to the team that it takes to do what this university does, both on the education side, on the research side, and everywhere in between. We are a team. We recognize that we're a team, and we appreciate what everybody does to help. Every time somebody writes a paper and publishes it, there were a whole bunch of people that helped make that happen. Every time somebody has a grant and successfully expends the money to run the experiments, there was a whole team of people who were making that happen. Teamwork is an incredible part of what this institution does, and it's one of the reasons why I've been here for 30 years. This is a great place to work. So, as Ken said, I am the interim vice president for research and innovation. I also, oddly enough, am the vice provost for budget and planning, which means that I keep all the money under my desk. I'm a professor of mathematics, and the rumors are not true. I do not bite, at least not very often. I bite when I have to. We have a really, really great research infrastructure here. We've been working for a long time to make that research infrastructure as smooth and effective and efficient as we possibly can. We are here to serve the research mission. I want you to remember that every time I say the word research, every time the provost says the word research, every time the president says the word research, we all mean research writ large. We mean the people who are in the labs. We mean the people who are choreographing the dances. We mean the people who are writing the poetry. We mean the economist. We mean the sociologist. We mean the accounting professor. Research writ large across this campus. We always mean that when we say research. Don't ever think that you're being left out just because you are not part of the grant writing structure of the university. I'm very happy that within my portfolio as research czar, for example, is the Oregon Humanities Center. I have a lot of fun talking to those folks, helping manage that very, very good organization. Now, the president has been out stumping recently, and I'm going to paraphrase what he's been saying. And I want you to take this home with you. I want you to tuck this in your brain. There are three priorities. Good things always come in threes. One, build the faculty and research excellence. Did you already forget what the word research means? Build the faculty and research excellence of the institution. That's number one. Number two, affordability and access. As an institution, we've got to make sure that the students can come, that they can be successful, that money is not a huge impediment. And three, excellence and success in education. We need to be providing the highest quality educational experience and the most successful educational experience that we can possibly provide. The president is angry. He is angry that the four-year graduation rate here at the University of Oregon is only 49%. That is an unacceptable number. It's unacceptable to me, it's unacceptable to the provost, and is really unacceptable to him. Our six-year graduation rate, which I think is actually a better measurement, our six-year graduation rate is only 69%. That's not acceptable. It should be higher. Three priorities: research excellence, access affordability, excellence and success in our educational environment. Whatever you're doing every day, if it doesn't feed one or more of those things, don't do it. Every day. If you're an accountant, help us make sure that our finances are running smoothly, because that affects all of those three. If you're serving students in the front line of a department office, do that beautifully. Make those students happy. Get them the information they need. Deal with them effectively and efficiently, because that affects all three of those goals. They're beautiful goals because almost every time you're doing anything all day long, you can actually see yourself in those goals. They're also very obvious goals, so they're easy to remember. So what were they again? I'm just going to make absolutely sure that nobody leaves here without knowing the goals. What was the first one? Build a faculty research excellence. Thank you. What was the second one? Access and affordability. How can you affect access and affordability? Don't do things that will drive up our costs. If you see a way to help us bring down our costs without sacrificing our quality, tell us about it. It's amazing. Especially, this is so important for people with new eyes, right? You're all new to the institution. You're not ingrained in the Oregon way yet, I hope. Most of you haven't been here long enough to be ingrained in the Oregon way. Your fresh eyes, whether you're faculty, whether you're an OA, your fresh eyes are hugely valuable to us. So when you see something that can be done better, that can be done less expensively, more effectively, let us know, because that actually affects the bottom line and helps us stay more affordable. What was the third one? Excellence and success in our teaching, in our educational mission. That one we can all do every day. It's very, very easy. It's so easy to keep our eye on that, because it's, you know, it's why so many of us are here. But it's everybody. It's not just the people in the classroom, okay? It's absolutely everybody can contribute to that mission. I'm tempted to have a test now. Whip out a piece of paper and write them. No, I won't do that. My office stands to support your work in all three of these areas. And of course, my office is best situated to help you with the research part of those three priorities. Later in the day, you'll be meeting with a couple of my associate vice presidents who will give you more information than you can possibly absorb about the services that are provided by my office. Let me just remind you, as I said earlier, it doesn't matter whether you're a chemist or an economist or a poet. My office is a good resource. Our job is to help you with your research excellence. So don't think that we've turned our back on you just because you're not writing grants. We're there to help you. I would like to see if there's anybody that has any questions. Yes?
Why is there such a low graduation rate?
There are roughly 24,000 students on this campus, and our graduation rate is roughly 50%. So I would say that there are 12,000 reasons why our graduation rate is as low as it is. And that's something that we actually need to understand better. And again, fresh eyes can be very helpful. We make assumptions because we've been here so long. But fresh eyes can really help us to try to figure that out. It is, of course, a combination of many things. Our students are highly prepared. So I don't think that's the primary problem. We do know that finances are probably the number one problem for why students are not able to finish. We have just launched, with some help from the state, a new program where we will be able to basically bridge students in the later part of their junior year or in their senior year, so that at the point where they start to run out of financial aid, federally financed loans, we will be able to step in and help them get to the finish line. So we're hoping that that program will have a big impact. But if you see reasons why students are falling through the cracks, let us know. Did I answer your question sufficiently? I mean, I didn't say anything that wasn't completely obvious, but it's okay. Other questions? Yes? In-state students are paying about $10,000. We are, one of the many things that I do in that budget job is examining our tuition structures, and we are in the process right now of looking at making some fairly major changes to our tuition structures with the intention of trying to find ways to help students be able to graduate on time, to incentivize them to graduate on time. Since I'm trying to stump a little bit for the president here, I really should come back and hammer on one of his primary points, and it speaks to exactly what you're asking. The real driver for making college non-affordable is not the ticket price. It's not really the tuition. It's those extra years that a student has to spend money. So a four-year education is a lot less expensive than a five-year education, which is a lot less expensive than a six-year education, which is a lot less expensive than a seven-year education. Every extra year, every extra term that a student spends here has a huge marginal cost to that student. So anything that we can do to improve those graduation rates, the difference between the four-year and the six-year, get students to graduate more quickly, is a way of making college more affordable. And then the flip side of that is what is the cost of an education if you don't actually finish your education? As a mathematician, I say the limit is going to infinity. Okay? It's sort of infinitely expensive. If you come here for 2 years, you don't get a degree, then the cost of your degree is extremely high. So we also were trying to prevent that as much as we possibly can. Have I in any way answered your question?
Yeah. Can I ask a follow-up?
Sure. What percentage of students are paying in-state tuition? So amongst our undergraduate students, writ large across the whole campus, I believe that we are, Sue's going to tell me if I'm wrong, but I believe we are 54.6%. Okay. I'm thinking last year. Okay, she didn't know it. We're a little over half of our undergraduates by headcount are resident students. A lot of those resident students aren't paying any tuition at all because of our Pathways program. So we have an extremely good program that meets the full financial needs of students who are Pell eligible. Okay. By the way, 50% non-resident, 50% resident is a political challenge for us. We recognize that. But it is one of the reasons why the doors are still open. It's one of the primary reasons why all of you could be hired. Those non-residents who are coming here and are paying a much higher tuition, they are keeping the university afloat. We appreciate what they are doing for the university enormously. That's a very important thing to recognize. Those students are paying well over $30,000 a year in tuition. Other questions? Our operating budget is a little over $400 million, and about $350 million of that is tuition. Our entire budget for the university is just a little less than $1 billion. We differentiate between our operating budget, which is what we call our E&G, and our auxiliary and service center budgets. Auxiliaries are things like housing, parking, everybody's favorite, parking. so we have a bunch of units like that, and those units are all self-sufficient. Housing, for example, is completely self-sufficient. We don't use any state dollars. We don't use any tuition dollars to support housing. You've got a technical answer to your question. It's your fault. Other questions? Well, thank you for letting me come and talk to you. Try to represent the president a little bit here. And I hope that you get to meet the president very soon. He is a very inspiring fellow. I think we're all very, very lucky that he has come to join us. He's going to pump a lot of energy into this university, and hopefully he's going to pump a lot of money into the university too. Thank you very much.
This discussion of students and affordability reminds me of a story, and you've already gotten to know me this morning. Stories come out easily. My children have numbered them. I moved here from a private research university where one might probably unfairly, but nonetheless one might categorize the students as students of privilege and opportunity. When I came to the University of Oregon, I was teaching a very large lecture class in Columbia 150, which none of you will have had a chance to teach in, and you won't appreciate how awesome it is starting winter term when the newly renovated Columbia 150 comes back online. But trust me, it's going to be terrific, and you'll be really happy you never saw the old version. But after one of my classes, a woman came rollerblading up to see me. She was the top performer in the class. She was 40 years old, single mother of two on rollerblades, working full-time to go through school. I knew I was someplace different from where I had been, and I really respect our students for what they're doing. And if we could all appreciate that they may be really sacrificing to try to be here, it helps us recognize these statistics and try to do something about them. The students aren't just statistics. University of Oregon is proud of a long history of shared governance. Here to speak with us is someone who I know in three roles. One is as president of the University of Oregon Senate. The other is lecture demonstrator in the Department of Chemistry, where he helps me teach in that room. And the third is as a friend, because Randy's been here a long time. Randy, please.
Well, thanks, Ken. I am first and foremost a teacher. I'm senior instructor. And as a teacher, it's been 55 minutes, time for a break, 20 minutes, 20 seconds to stand up and stretch. Come on, stand up and stretch, you know you want to. It's been 55 minutes. That's more than a class period, I'm sorry. After 50 minutes, I start wandering. It's like, class should be over. Oh, that's good. Oh, now you're all bright-eyed again. That's great. I am Randy Sullivan. I'm the president of your university senate. The senate is the primary elected representative body here. More about that later. But I wanted to start off because last night I was laying awake, at least 5 minutes, thinking about what pearl of wisdom I could distill to give you to welcome you to the University of Oregon. And I came up with three words. Carson Hall Dining. It's a dining hall right down there in the heart of campus. You get it on your, you can get the Dine On program, $6.25, all you can eat. Dorm food has sure gotten a lot better since I went to school. It's a hearth-baked pizza. And eventually, everybody who's anybody shows up at Carson Hall Dining. So, we are, most universities have a faculty senate. We are not unique in that we have instead a university senate. The statutory faculty delegated to a university senate its authority within the university governance structure so that most times we act as the voice of the faculty, but in so doing, or at least the elected representative voice of the faculty. But when that happened, when that delegation happened, it was delegated to a university senate. So we represent faculty, officers of administration, officers of research, staff, students. Am I leaving anybody out? Oh, librarians. Don't leave out the librarians. Hell hath no wrath like an irate librarian. I think that's it. All of them have senators that represent their constituencies in the University Senate. Our primary authority is with academic issues, as commonly understood. We frequently quibble about what's an academic issue or not. We have, substantive discussions about that with the administration, but that's what we do. One of the things we do, we are all constantly in the process of trying to decide what is an academic issue is commonly understood. Some things we definitely know are, and some things we definitely know aren't, and some things we talk about. But as with any parliamentary body, we also have the ability to pass resolutions on any issue, and so that's frequently where issues that involve the whole campus community kick in. And it's not an academic issue as commonly understood. The authority involved is less in the sense that we don't have statutory authority, but there is a great deal of influence involved in passing a resolution from the Senate that says this is the way the university community, through its elected representatives, feels about a particular issue. So that's kind of what we do. Our primary concern, I should say, though, is academic excellence. And we work with the board and the administration closely. It is the biggest thing on our agenda. Shared governance is extremely important as we move into the challenges that face a public university in the 21st century. First of all, we are intimately involved in what does that mean to be a public university in an era of decreased state funding. In a lot of ways, we start looking more like a private university in some respects. So we're constantly asking that question, and can't be answered glibly, what is it that makes us public? Some of those things are that we commonly agree on is a degree of transparency, oversight, affordability for Oregon students and for other students. And the Senate plays a role in that. Also, in being especially watchful of academic freedom, and freedom of discourse. So we're very involved in that. That's what we do. How does this impact you? Well, first of all, as I said, you've got an elected representative, whatever unit you're in, and officers of administration also. You have elected officer of administration representatives and the president of the OA council we frequently work with. So you have representative on the Senate. For those of you who are faculty, you have a representative, either probably within your department, if not within your department, within your school or college. So you can find out if you have issues dealing of, that you want to talk to your representative about. Get on the Senate website, find out who your representative is, and talk to them about it. A lot of you are at the beginning of your career at the University of Oregon. It's probably too early to be thinking about university service. You're probably going to want to settle into your units, get thinking about it, and probably your first service may be within your unit or within your discipline. But there should come a point in your career where you start thinking about service to the university as a whole. And that can be in the Senate, or that can be the Senate's, one of the Senate's other job is the oversight of university committees. University committees are the places where the university committee, university community comes together on particular issues of the particular committees to discuss issues of concern. When you're ready to do that, we welcome you. You can either come talk to the president, that'd be me, or we have an amazing executive assistant, Bettina Lynn. Stand up, Bettina. And she can help get you plugged in. One word of advice I would give to you is I find frequently with folks that are new to university service, they're like, I don't really know everything about this issue to sit on this committee, or I don't really know enough about the university as a whole to step into being a senator yet or run for Senate yet. Don't worry, number one, you probably know more than you think you do. And if you come with your willingness and the wit that God and $100,000 worth of higher education gave you, we have a place for you. And folks like Bettina and more experienced folks are great to coach you into it. If we waited for all our folks to know exactly what they were doing, we would never fill any of the committees or the Senate. We get in there, and it's the nature of shared governance that we all get in and do the best we can with what we know about the issues. And that's one of the reasons why we depend so heavily on the folks in the administration that are the experts on their topics and have to work closely with them in order to help propel us into excellence. If you have, if you'd like more information, and at the website on the front of here, the Senate, we've put a newly generated trifold brochure. Of course, you're going to be seeing it online. So I used to teach the dental admissions test, the DAT. I taught a course for that, and they had a test where you had unfolded like boxes and things, and you had to figure out how they would look when they were folded up, kind of a spatial relations thing. That's the test when you go for there, because it's actually a trifold brochure. So you'll have to go to the site and look at it and fold it together in your mind. Or you could print it out on a color printer like it's supposed to go, and then you have a nice little trifold brochure. Now, any questions? Okay. Oh, yes.
What are the Senate's priorities for this year?
Senate's priorities for this year? Academic excellence. And through that, particularly, there's a recent restructuring, and remember, recent is a relative term in university governance. It takes a while to get things going sometimes. We had formed an academic council, which is representatives from all the committees who deal with academic issues, coming together with key administrators to deal with academic issues. And I'm really interested in empowering that, so the academic council, so that they can deal with academic issues. We're still going to be dealing with sexual assault issues. There's a huge concern among our constituencies. A lot's been done. The Senate's going to want to maintain oversight over that and see that voices are being heard and that that process is progressing in a way that's good for all of our beloved students and staff and OAs and all the constituents. We have to remember this is a community-wide problem, not just a student problem. Good question. I think those are going to be some of the main ones. Come to the first Senate meeting and I'll lay out some more for you. Any other questions? Yes. Well, our Constitution says that theoretically we're supposed to meet once a month. That didn't happen last year. It was an interesting year last year. We met more often than that. This year we're going to average a little bit less than two a month, and I hope to be able to cancel some of those. We're trying to head it back to once a month. I'm not sure that with university and the governance in the 21st century we'll ever be able to get it to back to once a month, but it's an aspirational goal. Isn't that what they call those, aspirational goals? It's an aspirational goal, yeah. Other questions?
Are they public meetings?
Oh, absolutely, yeah. In fact, and if you can't make it, we record them. In fact, at the end of the year before last, the Senate passed a legislation requiring almost all of the university committees to also be open. And so they post their agendas and their place of meeting. Now, sometimes it's up to the chair whether an observer can talk or not. Sometimes, and most of them, if you do have something to add, you can raise your hand, depending on what's going on, and get some input there. But you can go and sit in on it. Okay. And if you don't make it to a Senate meeting, we do video record them on the Senate website, senate.uoregon.edu. You can go there, and there's links to the Senate meetings. And if you are just interested in what's going on or really bored and don't want to watch Dancing with the Stars, you can go watch a Senate meeting. No, it really is a tremendous resource to have them online and people to watch them online. Other questions? Okay, I think we're there again.
The sessions, I'll add, not only are recorded, but they're carried live as well. So if you can't make it there, you can watch. And if you learn Randy's cell phone number, you can call him at old meeting and probably ask a question. I advocate regularly for Senate service. When I was an assistant professor, someone put me on the ballot to run for the Senate, and my colleagues responded so negatively, I actively campaigned against my candidacy and succeeded in not even being elected an alternate. That was a long time ago. Senate service can take a lot of time if you want it to. It can not take so much time if you're busy. And I really, you need to listen to your colleagues, but I really feel that it need not be a piece of service that you should actively campaign against. It's our representation. I like this trifold sense. I think there's probably more than three folds in the image in my mind, but Randy talked about some of the Senate's priorities. We heard Doug and Susan and Brad talk about some of the president's and provost priorities. We will hear from our union representation after our coffee break. They have priorities as well. These are not three separate pieces. There's a lot of overlap. So this trifold turns it into a kind of a unified package of things that we care about as an institution. We're actually pretty much on schedule. Before we take a break, I'd like to take advantage. I held off in introducing the other representatives, Office of Academic Affairs and from the Provost Office, because they were working and I wanted you to be able to see them. I think they're here now. I want to start with Sonia Runberg, who is Senior Executive Assistant in Office of Academic Affairs, and all logistics for this meeting, which bringing in 30 to 40 folks from the university, 150 or so of us in the room, catering, 6-page catering menu for the day. Sonia took care of all of that, and thank you so much. Because this is your orientation, you won't know what previous groups' orientations look like, but this one is different. And after the coffee break, it's going to be more different. You're not going to need the stretches so much as Randy provided you the opportunity with. We have, a mixed bag of things that I'll introduce to you somewhat later. The revisioning of this orientation from a fascinating but lengthy series of talking heads to something more palatable is thanks to Gretchen Drew, our Strategic Communications Director. And then I'm going to do shorter and less flowery introductions to the other members of staff, but I will tell you that what keeps me coming to work every day with joy on my bicycle, I'm a bicycle commuter, by the way, is the opportunity and honor of getting to work with the people I'm introducing you to now, okay, including Susan and Doug, who you've already met, Gretchen and Sonia. Rand Bramhall is Assistant Vice Provost and Senior Instructor of Business. Dave Hubin is a professor of history and senior assistant to the senior vice provost. Should have gotten Tammy Orr earlier. If you come to visit us in academic fairs, and I hope you will see Tammy first. And you'll be happy you saw Tammy first because she's the friendly one. Actually, we all are. Please do come to see us. Pam Palinuk is Administrative Director in Academic Affairs, way over there. Kathy Warden is not here at present. She is Operations and Project Manager in the Office of the Provost and Academic Affairs. And we thought that if we are a welcoming and service-oriented office, there should probably be somebody there. And so Kathy is back in Johnson Hall, but thank you, Kathy. Karen Jeffries is Director of Financial Services, so all things money. Except for the money that's under Brad's desk. Finally, Jane Gordon, you had the opportunity to see on the video. She's Interim Vice Provost for the Portland program. She has also been invaluable to us over the past number of years now in the implementation of the collective bargaining agreement. Jane is in Portland. She's not here. If you didn't know we had Portland programs, learn about them. If you do know about the Portland programs, go. You saw the White Stag building there in the video. Remarkable facility. You really, really want to visit and see what opportunities there are there. With that, and a minute to spare, again, you haven't seen earlier orientations, but you don't know how relaxed I'm feeling right now. That may change after the break, but for now we're going to take a good coffee break, re-engage in those conversations you were having before I shut them all down to start the session, and we will see you back here at 10:35. Thank you. Sorry to interrupt again, but I do want to get on with the rest of our programming here. I mentioned earlier this morning the campus is about to get more crowded. Those of us who were here during the summer might get a little grumpy about that even, especially when you get run over by bicycles walking on 13th. Who are these people? What are they doing here? Well, they're the students. They, of course, are the reason we're all here. So this session now is meant to give you just a snapshot, a sense of the students at the University of Oregon. We're going to start with Kathy Stanley, representing the Vice President for Student Life's Office. Kathy is the Associate Vice President and Chief of Staff to Robin Holmes, the Vice President for Student Life. And we also have joining Kathy, Cheryl Eister, Associate Dean of Students.
Good morning. I understand you're on time today, so no pressure as we try to cram a lot of information in a very short period of time. It's great to see you all here today. I vaguely remember my first day almost 30 years ago, so I hope you're here with the same level of excitement and energy that I had then, and I'm happy to report I still have most of that on most days. On behalf of our Vice President, Robin Holmes, who, as Ken mentioned, couldn't be here today, let me add my formal welcome to you and those you've already received this morning. Can you hear me okay? I don't usually have a problem with people hearing me. We don't have a lot of time, so I'm going to give you just a quick overview. Obviously, I couldn't stand up here in a few minutes and tell you everything about students or student life, nor would I try. The Division of Student Life has 8 departments. We have a multitude of co-curricular opportunities and programs for our students. We have more than 750 professionals who work every day to ensure that the student experience complements the academic experience. We think that the total academic experience, of course, includes both of those things, and we're doing what we can to make sure that we can take the information that they learn and help them translate that to the real world and the futures that we hope are bright. We deliver healthcare, physical, mental, dental. We deliver prevention programs and career advice. We deliver leadership training and late night activities. We provide a place for students to rest and enjoy a meal. And most of all, we deliver community involvement and support. Our employees, including 200 officers of administration and 70 officers of instruction, work in the Career Center, the Counseling and Testing Center, the Erb Memorial Union. You may have noticed the construction fences in the middle of campus. That's the student union, the Erb Memorial Union. We're right in the middle of a $95 million renovation and expansion, and that'll be complete next fall. Some things are going to be available this fall, of course, but we'll be fully finished next fall. We have the Health Center. We have the Holden Center for Leadership and Community Engagement. We have university housing, and as Ken mentioned, it's going to get crowded. Tomorrow, we're going to help move several thousand new students into the residence halls in an event we call Unpack the Quack. We have physical education and recreation. Both we teach 4-credit PE classes, and we also have a rec center. And the Office of the Dean of Students, and you're going to hear a little bit more about that from Cheryl in a minute. While our primary focus is on students, of course, we actually have some services and programs for faculty and staff. And I just want to highlight a couple of them for you. You can purchase a membership to the Rec Center. And it's now a lot bigger than it was before we expanded it last year. And so my understanding is that we're able to offer more opportunities for faculty and staff to work out and participate in some of those programs. If you don't want a membership, we actually also have some workouts that you can do if you're not a member. And you can also join intramurals. There are a number of faculty and staff intramural teams at the Rec Center. And the Rec Center website, of course, has information on how you can participate in that. We also run the food venues on campus. And as much as it's great to maybe get off campus for an hour over your lunch hour, we have lots of places that you can eat on campus. You may have heard Starbucks just opened up in the EMU on Monday. And we are also going to be opening up a number of retail establishments there, some this fall, some, there's a couple I think that will open up in the winter, including Subway, Joe's Burgers, Chipotle. There'll be a pub next year in the student union. And we also operate 9 self-operated food services, including Duck's Bistro in the Living Learning Center and Big Mouth Burrito in Hamilton Complex. So on the housing website, if you want to go to food venues, lots of places to eat on campus. We actually have a program for faculty and staff called Ducks Dine On. So if you want to load up a Ducks Dine On card with some cash, the more you load up, the cheaper that it gets. So the more meals that you get, makes it very convenient if you're in a hurry and just need to grab something. And that's at any of the venues, including the Grab and Go Marketplace, which is like a sort of a small convenience store. So lots of opportunity. And then the Health Center actually offers immunizations. We do a flu shot clinic every year for faculty and staff with some specific times, so you'll be able to go in and maybe not have to wait quite as long. And also we have a travel clinic for immunizations for those that are going to travel. So that's just a little bit of information about some of the services we have for faculty and staff in addition to what we do for our students. So I encourage you to go to the Student Life website. I think in your materials there's some information about that. Check out our departments. We'd love it if you come by and visit. Of course, if you have questions, we'd like you to call. And I will say that fortunately, most of our students have an extraordinarily positive experience at the U of O, but occasionally they don't, and occasionally they need a little help. And what I'd like to do is introduce my colleague Cheryl Eister. And Cheryl, as Ken mentioned, is the Associate Dean of Students. And she's going to talk to you about a couple of things that we think are important and valuable for you to have. One is something that, of course, we've all seen in the news, is what are we doing around sexual assault prevention and response? So she's going to talk a little bit about that. And then occasionally you will encounter a difficult student or a student in trouble, and she's going to talk a little bit about what you might do if that opportunity, if that situation comes your way. So without further ado, Cheryl Eister, thank you very much.
Thank you, Kathy. Again, my name is Cheryl. I work in the Office of the Dean of Students, and this is my this is a real exciting time of the year for me because I love welcoming students, and my 35th year of welcoming students, not on this campus, but I think this is the third campus I've been on. So it's really exciting to be here and welcome you. I know for some of you, it's your first job coming to a university, and for some of you, you're just transferring in, and it's very, very wonderful to see all the new people in the audience. I'm going to talk really quickly about two things that are very, very important to me, and that's the health and well-being of our students. And we need your help. And so one of the things that we do is we are a very caring institution, and we have some pretty big issues that we've been in the media about over the last year and a half or so. And to be transparent, we are really trying to work hard at what we're doing with our response and our prevention efforts to sexual violence. And we, among many colleges across the country, are trying to do that. And our goals are to reduce the incidence of sexual violence on our campus, to improve the students who are reporting, and helping them feel like this is a place where they can go, that they're going to be treated seriously if they report an incident of sexual harassment, and that includes sexual assault, dating and domestic violence, gender-based bullying or harassment, or stalking. Any of those issues, if anybody comes to you, all of us in this room are, if you're employed by the institution, we're all required reporters. And I think you're probably going to be getting some information more about your role on that. But I want to let you know that sometimes a listening ear from a faculty member or a staff member, that's what they need to get the foot in the door to our office. And our office in the Dean of Students, I have a crisis intervention and sexual violence support staff of two people who work round the clock with me, 365 days of the year, 24/7. We are responding to students at all times of the day and night. We are there within 25 minutes to help them if they want help. And we have a very comprehensive array of services, from medical SANE nurses and academic accommodations to the health center services that have trained. They have at least six IPV staff members that work on this issue. We have caring law enforcement, that we have a trained sexual violence police detective. We have the services available. The students are telling us they aren't aware of our services, and so we need your help in helping us promote those services. And I would love to hear, if you come from other institutions, how you've done it on your campus to make our services more visible. So send me a note if you're interested in working with us on that. So again, reducing incidents of sexual violence. We also want to improve our response and our prevention efforts. We are continuously working with our faculty to help understand our data and help us move forward in really using data to drive our decisions on what's effective with our students and how can we make this a safer place. We've got some really innovative things that we're doing this term. Our students, before they even get to the campus, are invited to take an online course called Haven, which is all about sexual assault. And then we have one called Alcohol EDU for alcohol, but they're also introduced in the summer to a theater troupe of our trained peer educators, and they're taught a little bit about bystander intervention and social norms on campus and healthy consent and healthy relationships. But this fall, we are one of, I believe, two institutions. I think the University of Michigan is doing something very similar right now. We are inoculating every single residence hall with a workshop, a 90-minute workshop. Every student will be required to go to around these issues, learning about bystander intervention, what's a healthy relationship, consent, social norming. We feel like we are really trying to get students in their target populations where they are at. We're also doing some other things within the university. I recently assume the leadership with the Fraternity and Sorority Life organization. We will be working to do an external review with that organization. We feel strongly about helping them really meet the values that they have put forward and who they say they are as an organization. And we are trying to really work with them in training their peer leaders. And so we've got a lot going on with students there. And we also are doing a lot more in terms of working with faculty and faculty and staff and graduate students. So there's wonderful programs that we have. The two most critical ones that I would like you to know about are, write this down, our SAFE hotline. The SAFE hotline is 541-346-SAFE. The SAFE hotline is a confidential hotline that any student can call during any time of the day or night, and they can be, they're talking to a trained counselor, not just a student peer-led, you know, crisis line, but a trained psychologist counselor who is going to navigate them to if they want to report to the university, if they don't want to report to the university, if they want to be connected to an advocate on campus, if they want to be connected to an advocate off campus, if they want to, whatever their issue is, that person will take the call, get it to the university if they want university services or somewhere else, if they want help somewhere else. That line is critical for all of you to know about. The second thing is we have a robust new website for students called safe.uorgan.edu. I would hope that if any time a student came your way, you would be able to point a student in the direction of that website. It is highly comprehensive. We are already getting calls from people across the country saying, how did you do this? Because we've got some great navigation buttons on it for a student to really try and understand who's confidential on the campus, who's not. And it is a wonderful new website that has been created to be as transparent as we can for students, but also to help our students in navigating when they are harmed. So those two resources are very important. The other thing I wanted to talk about is many of you, whether you are a staff member working in housing, whether you're a faculty member, whether you're a staff member, many of you are going to come across a student who is not well, a student who may have a mental health issue. It could be a student who's behaving erratically in a classroom. It could be somebody who is struggling with addiction, or it could be somebody who's withdrawn, isolated. I mean, there's an array of different kinds of examples of student behaviors that we see every day and that we are trying to work with our students if they're depressed, if they're withdrawn, if they're isolated, if they are off their medications. We have systems in place at the university where you can turn for help, and that you as a staff member are not, unless it's in your role saying this is what you do at the university, you are not required to handle these on your own. We have teams of people, and many, actually several teams of people, that work on these kinds of issues for you. I would say the best thing to do is, if you're unsure, call the Dean of Students office. We can help get you connected to either the Dean's Consultation Team, which I'm a member of, that looks at serious cases on our campus of mental health, or we could get you connected to a University Counseling and Testing Center staff member who could help you just talk about a student who may seem more withdrawn in your class, and it might not rise to the level of a major kind of a situation. But we have services in place. We encourage you to use those services. That's what they're there for. The Dean of Students is a good place to start that conversation. And I would highly recommend that you use and work with us from the early stages of whenever you're seeing a behavior that is not looking like behavior that's, you know, trust your gut feeling. It's something that you're just feeling uncomfortable about. If at any time at all, that you are feeling unsafe as a staff member, a faculty member, you need to call UOPD. That is what we do around here. I've even called UOPD myself when I feel like, you know what, I'm not feeling real safe about the situation. You need to get used to who the resources are. Our police officers will be dispatched immediately. And if you see something that you think somebody else on campus is in an unsafe situation, that's also a spot where we're here to help in any way that we can. So call UOPD, call our office. We will get somebody there to help you immediately. So that's, I mean, the critical things that I think you need to know. I mean, I got a whole, like, dissertation here full of stuff I could tell you, but those are the things that I really think are the most important for right now. So Welcome again, and it's exciting to see all of you, and good luck in the rest of your day.
I wish we never had to think about things like that, but we do be involved. Our next speaker deserves a lengthy introduction, but I want to give him time to speak, so I'm simply going to say next up is Jim Brooks, Assistant Vice President for Enrollment Management.
Thanks, Ken. Good morning, everyone. I would like to join with others and welcome you to our campus. Kathy mentioned that she had been here for quite a while. I have been here. I've just finished my fourth year at the University of Oregon, and I have to say it's been a good 4 years, and I think you're coming into a wonderful community, a very welcoming community, the community that their things are designed to make sure you're successful. So I say welcome as well. So I'm here today representing the Office of Enrollment Management. Usually our Vice President for Enrollment Management, Dr. Roger Thompson, is here, but he's unable to be here today. He sends his regrets, and he sends his welcome to you as well. Enrollment management at the University of Oregon is comprised of several offices that are all working together to ensure that we recruit, retain, and give a good experience to students who come to the University of Oregon. To tell you real quickly, the Office of Admissions, probably the one you're probably most familiar with when it comes to enrollment management, the office that does all our heavy recruiting, going out into the community, around the neighborhoods, around the state, around the country, around the world, recruiting students to the University of Oregon, and our Office of Admissions is led by Jim Rollins. I lead the Office of Student Financial Aid and Scholarships, the entity charged with administering federal, state, institutional foundation funds that go to University of Oregon students. We do probably about $235 million a year in financial aid to our students. That's excluding athletics. That's strictly going to non-athletes. So we are doing our best to try and ensure that the University of Oregon remains affordable. The university registrar is Sue Evelyn, who actually is sitting in the back of the room and I think speaks to you later today, but Sue's office manages all the registrar functions for the institution, and those of you on the faculty will probably be interacting with her or her staff in some form during your time here. We also comprise the Office of Student Orientation Programs, which is led by Cora Bennett, and Orientation Programs handles all of our summer orientation, introduction, the week of welcome, all the things that we're doing to help students transition from high school into the University of Oregon. We then have Lynn Egley, who leads our office budget and financial administration division as a large division within the university. We have someone who makes sure that we are being fiscally responsible and that we're using the funds the university allocates to us in the best manner we can. Jonathan Jacobs leads our enrollment management research group. We try to be very strategic and use research to drive what we do. We're not just out there kind of going on a wing and a prayer and hoping everything works out, but we try to be very strategic and focus in how we recruit students, what we do to retain students, and how we help students through the process to graduation. Of course, as enrollment management, we do a lot in the way of communications with students, not just prospective students, high school students, but also students who are here already and working with students. And Holly Simons leads the Office of Strategic Communications within enrollment management, helping us do that. And then we have someone new who's part of the enrollment management team, who actually is sitting in the room as well. Jen Parker is our new development officer, and Jen will be working with us to help fundraise for enrollment management and student initiatives, financial aid, things like that. So we're a group that's working together, as I said, to give our students the best experience we can and to make sure that we support students from recruitment all the way to graduation and into their status as alumni. The goal for enrollment management, obviously, is to recruit students to the University of Oregon. As I said, we do that within the state, we do that within the country, we do that around the world. We want to increase the quality of our entering class. And you say, how do we measure quality? Well, we're looking at high school GPA, we're looking at SAT scores. As an AAU institution, we attract some of the best students. And so we continue to want to grow that, so that those who are faculty are working with students who are prepared for college and are prepared to help you as faculty members and researchers be successful. We also want to increase the diversity of our class. This is a challenge somewhat being in Oregon. We look at diversity as far as race and ethnicity, but we also look at diversity when it comes to socioeconomic status. We want a student body that is very rounded, and so that our students are exposed to all different types of people, all different races, all different ethnicities, and that they truly are prepared to go out into a global world and be successful. We recruit international students for that reason. We think they bring a huge part of our student population, and they bring a lot of experiences to students who may not have ever had those experiences. And so that also helps them be prepared to go forward. And as I said before, we work on keeping the University of Oregon affordable. One of the things we've done in the last 3 or 4 years is to totally look at how we use our institutional aid funds. The institution gives money back to the aid office that comes out of tuition to help support students. And so we've revamped all our scholarship programs, we've put more money into financial aid, we've grown our programs that serve needy students, because we want to ensure that that need and the cost is never an issue, is never a deterrent to a student enrolling at the University of Oregon. And then we want to increase retention and graduation rates. That ultimately is the ultimate goal and the ultimate proof that a student has had a successful experience and that they're ready to go out into the world and change the world. And so we work with you on that as well. As far as what we've been able to do over the last 6 years, which is probably about as long as enrollment management has existed, we have had some successes along these lines. We have managed to raise the GPA of the incoming class from about a 3.52 GPA to what will probably be around a 3.61 GPA this fall, and we will continue to work on that. We're really pleased that we've made some differences in the domestic minorities coming into the university. 6 years ago, about 17% of the incoming freshman class were domestic minorities. This fall, about 28% of our incoming freshman class will be domestic minorities in a state where domestic minorities make up about 21% of the population. So we've made some headway there, and we're really pleased with that and looking forward to continuing to grow that. Just as a tidbit of information, we enroll students from every state in the union, from over 100 countries, and from the state of Oregon, we enroll students from every county in the state of Oregon. So we truly are, we like to think of ourselves as an international university. We are the AAU institution in the state of Oregon, and I think that carries a lot of weight and it means a lot. And so we do some of these things by basically being focused. We focus on our students. We focus on the faculty, we focus on the staff, alumni, community members, friends of UO, realizing that it takes a village, and we are all a community, and we work together to make the university successful. We also try to be strategic, as I said. We look at the marketplace. We obviously are recruiting heavily with high school students who change. Their interests change, the way they communicate change, and so we're always assessing what we're doing, trying to ensure that we're staying out in front, that we're not always playing catch up, but that we're out front and we're meeting students where they are. We try to be flexible. Things change all the time. And so as I said, we assess things, we make changes, we make adjustments. We do things to ensure that we continue to be successful in promoting the University of Oregon. And we try to do this in an energetic way. Obviously, students aren't very excited by somebody who stands and just talks at them and bores them to death. So we use lots of different ways to reach out to students. This past weekend, we had a group of students on campus before the football game. Prospective students brought in several of them, took them to the game, took them to a reception before the game where they got to interact with staff. This past weekend, we were also involved in Comic-Con in Portland. I have to say, I've never been to Comic-Con in my life, but for this weekend, I was there for the first time as we promoted our comic studies minor. So we're trying to do different things to be where students are and get out there. On your tables, I left in true enrollment management function, I had to leave you something to take away because I don't want you to walk away empty-handed. But I put a copy of our 2014 annual report there. You can take a look at it. It talks about all the units within enrollment management, what we're doing, what we accomplished in the past year. So take a look at that. It'll give you some information as well. Once again, I want to welcome you here. I want to thank you for the partnership that we will have with you over the years to basically help grow the University of Oregon and bring students here who will be successful. Thank you very much. Welcome.
Thank you, Jim. A few minutes ago, we heard from Randy Sullivan, and I hope you heard some of the passion from the faculty and staff for shared governance here at the University of Oregon. If there's a group with greater passion for governance, it may be our students through the Associated Students of the University of Oregon, ASUO. And speaking here on their behalf is their president, Helena Schlegel.
Hi, everyone. How are you all doing? Pretty good. This is a bizarre opportunity because usually I'm sitting down and you all are lecturing to me, so I'm going to like take advantage of this one time I get to talk to faculty instead of being talked to. So I'm the student body president here at the U of O, and it's formally known as the ASUO, and we only have one recognized student government that represents all undergraduate students, graduate students, and the law students, and that's kind of unique because usually bigger universities split it up, so it's graduate student governments and undergraduate. The ASUO is actually one of the most powerful student governments in the country. We have a budget of almost $16 million that's completely autonomous from any other branch of the university. We have complete control over our money, and students actually pay into this fund through the incidental fee, which they pay about $220 a year. That goes toward a big budget that provides services on campus. And I wasn't here for Randy's, and so I don't know what he talked about with faculty. But our services are really student-centered, and we have student programs, about 180 student programs that range from anywhere from like the LGBTQA and the Multicultural Center to Safe Ride, which is our assault prevention shuttle, or DDS, which gets folks home from the bars late at night, works until 3 a.m. And you all actually have access to some of those services as well. I work for Safe Ride for the last 2 years, and we have a few regulars that are faculty members, so it's always fun to hear you all. I say regular because it is every day at the same time at the same place, so we get along. So we have student programs, we have non-academic departments, and we also have some contracts within the ASUO. We provide free bus tickets, and I say free because they already pay for it, but free bus passes with the LTD bus service. We also have the agreement with the athletics department for student tickets to all the athletic events. And we also pay into services like the Oregon Student Association to be connected in Salem and elsewhere, lobbying for a lower tuition and things like that. Each year, the people in power change. There's an election each spring, which I'm sure you'll see on 13th Avenue, and just like stay away the first few weeks of spring term, I promise. Like find a new route to walk to your classes because it gets ugly. But each year we have different things. This year we're gonna be working on expanding the counseling center. That's one of our big goals because there's limited counseling resources on campus. We also wanna increase overall physical and mental accessibility on campus and obviously keep college affordable and accessible to all. We really see ourselves as allies to the students, and in any way where we recruit, we feel like we need to make this campus a safe place that everyone finds that niche that they want, and so that's why we pride ourselves on having so many different programs. A few other things we're going to be working on are making cultural competency trainings, which actually the faculty and staff will be invited to as well, so if you all are interested in working with us on that, that would be great to collaborate on. And I guess I will close by saying that the students at the U of O are different. And if you've worked in another campus, I'm sure you heard that at your campus too. But we're active, we're politically active, we're aware, we really critically look at questions and or things that are proposed to us and ask questions. And I think you'll see that. You'll see the protests, you'll see students challenging you in courses. And I just wanna encourage you to like engage with them, because my best experiences in classrooms and lecture settings was when we really like got to have that dialogue and students really got to get engaged in the community. And so I look forward to working with you all, and welcome to campus. And if I have one other piece of advice, it's to ask in your first class, ask the students to help you make the O, because students love teaching people how to make the O, and it's always better if you know how to make the O like properly instead of like getting judged by your classes. But thank you and welcome. It's like this.
If we had a little more time, we could get a lesson right now. Before we move on, I want to say just one other thing. It's been mentioned, tomorrow's move-in day. It's always a moving time for me, and I do like puns, but I didn't intend that one. It's an incredible thing that's happening, and I just did this with my youngest child a couple weeks ago, so it'll get me especially today. But look at what is happening tomorrow. These parents are bringing their children here. They're going to leave them in our hands and think that's a good idea. So, and it is, but it's a hard time for them. If you're out walking and you see parents moving in with their children, you know, offer them a tissue. Or what I think is neat is just say hello and maybe introduce yourself, and you walk away and you can hear in the background, I just met a chemistry professor. It was so cool. They love to know that their kids are going to be in good hands. So keep in mind what's happening tomorrow. We've been using the word community a lot this morning. Speaking of communities, I want to start bringing my panel up here as I introduce them. We use this word regularly here to talk about the special place we work at, about the special people we interact with, or maybe even special people we don't interact with, but we might like to on a regular basis. I've been here 26 years. You heard other year durations mentioned, 28 years, 30 years. Susan refuses to tell us, but it's been a while. So I'm kidding. We come here and we stay. I had no intention of staying when I came here 26 years ago, and I have no intention of leaving. It's the community that does this. For this session, we're going to do things a little bit differently because you're really tired of people standing at the podium and speaking with you. So we're going to have people sit and speak to you, but in a different way. Four remarkably talented people who represent four very different but interrelated support structures that I think together help us develop this concept of community on campus. So let me introduce to you, I'm going to do them in the order I wrote them down because it's random, Yvette Alex Asenso, who's Professor of Political Science and Vice President for Equity and Inclusion. We have Bruce McAllister, who is the University Ombudsperson. We could probably call you an ombudsman, but we call it an ombudsperson. Kaya Rogers, who is the Director of Human Resources Programs. And Penny Doherty, Director of the Office of Affirmative Action and Equal Opportunity. So please take it away.
So I guess since I'm sitting closest to the lectern, I'll just go ahead and grab the mic first. We are going to engage you at first in letting you know how our offices assist in developing a sense of community here. And then we're going to ask you to engage at your tables around the question of community, and are there other ways in which you imagine that we could assist you with that? So I'm going to start with the Office of Affirmative Action and Equal Opportunity. And I will start by saying the University of Oregon is absolutely committed to supporting, to attracting and supporting a community in which a variety of perspectives, of experiences, of backgrounds are welcomed, are included, are valued within our community, because all of that is really essential to creating community. So consistent with that commitment, the University of Oregon has policies that prohibit discrimination against groups that historically have been subject to discrimination within our country and are today protected from discrimination under federal and state law. Those include protection on the basis of race, ethnicity, national origin, sex, religion, age, disability, veteran status, sexual orientation, gender identity, gender expression. So all of those are areas in which any kind of unfair, different, and less favorable treatment on our campus is prohibited. When anyone in our community, whether that be students, faculty, staff, even visitors to our campus, feel that they have been treated unfairly, the Office of Affirmative Action is a resource to get assistance with that concern where it raises a possible concern about discrimination. So I would say to you, as we work at developing community, that if you as individuals have any questions or concerns related to prohibited discrimination, please know that the Office of Affirmative Action is a resource to you. Please feel free to call us. Whether that concern or question affects you on a personal basis, whether that is a concern that is based on your observation about a dynamic within your classroom, within your workplace, whether it's something that's been reported to you, shared with you as a concern by a student or a colleague or even a visitor. And please know that if you have credible information that prohibited discrimination is occurring, because the issue of discrimination is a community issue, we really rely on each and every member of our institution as a partner in our effort to ensure that we are meeting our commitment. And so consistent with that, if you have credible information that prohibited discrimination is occurring, you actually have a duty to report that either to your supervisor or to the Affirmative Action Office. And the intent is that so that we can resolve those issues early, preferably before they become more disruptive than they already are. And the Affirmative Action Office is there to be a partner with you in that effort. But we need your participation as a critical partner. Sexual harassment and violence on college campuses is an issue that is receiving very well-deserved national attention. It is an issue to which we are directing a lot of effort on our campus. We are committed to providing and ensuring a community that is free of sexual harassment and sexual violence. But again, that is a community issue. We really require partnership of everyone on our campus to be engaged with the issue, to help us as we address education, prevention, and response to those issues. And I want to make sure that you understand that sexual violence is a severe form of sexual harassment. So if information comes to you regarding sexual violence, it falls within your responsibility to report when you have credible information so that that issue comes forward. Again, it's a community issue. We need partners throughout our campus. We are also committed to providing a community that ensures access to students, employees, and visitors, members of the public, with appropriate accommodation when that is necessary to accommodate someone who has a disability. We've got many people working on that across campus to ensure that our facilities are accessible, information is accessible, technology is accessible. But it is a community issue. If you become aware of something where we maybe have access issues, would appreciate your bringing that forward, would want you to know as new employees that the Affirmative Action Office is the partner you would turn to if you require any form of accommodation. Or if you are planning a public event and there are questions about access to that event, we deal with those issues. Bottom line, our office is a resource to you to help you feel connected to the community, to help you in your efforts to help build community. Please don't ever hesitate to call if you have a question, if there's something you'd like to chat about, if you think something made you uncomfortable and it might constitute prohibited discrimination. If you have a question and you're not sure whether it really belongs in affirmative action, or you're not sure if it rises to the level to call, I'd ask you to err on the side of calling. If I think there's another office that can better serve you, we'll get you connected with that office. And we can help kind of assess, is this a matter where some intervention is needed? So those are the ways in which the Affirmative Action Office is working to develop and sustain community here on our campus, and I welcome you to be part of that community and really look forward to your partnership in our efforts. Thank you.
Good morning. My name is Kaya Rogers. I am the Director of HR Programs in our central HR office. And I'm here today really wearing two hats. Some of you may have seen me sitting in the back table over there, as I am also new to the university. I've been here about 6 months and am excited to be here today to make connections with all of you and to learn more about the university. My other hat is I am here representing the Office of Human Resources, and I wanted to mention that our Chief Human Resources Officer, Nancy Resnick, unfortunately was very disappointed that she wasn't able to be here today. She was called away on some university business, but she really wanted me to extend her welcome to all of you, and again, her regrets for not being able to be here personally. As I was thinking about our discussion today, I came up with two words that I feel like really sum up how the Human Resources Office really engages to help build community across campus. And the two words, the first one is connect, and the second is engage. So if you remember nothing else about anything I talk about today, I hope you remember those two words, connect and engage. Many of you, whether you knew it or not, have actually already connected with Human Resources from the time that you maybe very first viewed a position opening that we had, maybe you filled out an application, engaged with some search committees. Human Resources supports supervisors and hiring authorities through all of that. We have experts who help with benefits enrollment, and I would like to take a moment to do a little plug this afternoon at the Knight Library. There, you will have the opportunity to speak with some of our benefits experts, whether you're enrolling in benefits for the first time or preparing for annual enrollment that starts next month. You'll have the opportunity to talk with some experts who can answer your questions and guide you through those processes. We also have, in Human Resources, we have a lot of work and life resources available to you as you and your families transition. Maybe you're new to the community or to the state. Maybe you've been here a while, but you're new, you know, obviously new to the university. Lots of resources available to help with that transition. After you've been here a while, we also have many resources available to help engage you and continue to engage you with the community within the University of Oregon. We have a wide variety of professional development opportunities that are available to all of our faculty and staff. And we also have resources available to help with any issues you have potentially with a supervisor or within your department. And we could partner with any of the offices that are represented here today as necessary to help with any of those types of concerns, as well as the Office of Human Resources puts together a number of recognition events, years of service, outstanding service, those types of things. So many different activities and resources available through the Central Office of Human Resources to help build community. So for those of you who maybe haven't directly engaged with Human Resources yet, I would really encourage you to either stop by our office on the very, very furthest other side of campus in the Peace Health North building. You can feel free to give us a call at any time, and especially if you have any questions, any concerns, or are you looking for further resources to help you connect or engage with the university community. Thank you.
Good morning, everybody. I'd like to begin the discussion by basically thinking about two different definitions of community. One is the idea of people just inhabiting a common space, and they're joined together by a common characteristic. So that example might be University of Oregon is our common space, and we're all joined together because we are employed or study or learn or engage in some way at the University of Oregon. So that's one definition of community. A second definition of community that I actually think I'd like all of us to think about adapting is this notion of community based on fellowship. Not just being a part of the same space or sharing the same characteristics, but actually having a feeling of fellowship with one another, caring and a common wheel of working together toward a common goal. And that goal is academic excellence at the University of Oregon. And we do that from different perspectives. But in order to do it, we can't have the sort of passive definition of just inhabiting the same space, but a more engaged definition of actually belonging to a community and doing the kinds of things and having the kinds of attitudes that are necessary to maintain a fellowship within that community. So my work, I'm very honored to be here. I came to the University of Oregon 3 years ago. From Indiana University. I was there for almost 20 years as a professor of political science, a dean, and director of graduate studies. Name it, I did it, probably. And I'm very happy to be here. But my role here is as vice president of equity and inclusion and professor of political science. And the division of equity and inclusion comprises five different units. The Office of the Vice President for Equity and Inclusion, which is basically the policy and process aspect of that work. The Center for Multicultural Academic Excellence, which focuses primarily on graduate, undergraduate and graduate students of all sorts, focusing specifically on first generation, students of color, international students, students with disabilities to some extent, even though there is a separate office on campus responsible for that work. The Center on Diversity and Community focuses particularly on faculty and incorporating faculty into various aspects of equity, inclusion, and diversity work, regardless of whether you are from an underrepresented faculty group or not. That office provides assistance in teaching and research and engagement, skill development. The Multicultural Center, which is basically our activist center. So this is the center that partners with the Associated Student Union and really helps our students to engage in a variety of issues. And then finally, the Many Nations Longhouse, which is home to the university, but also serves as the ambassadorial site for Oregon's 9 federally recognized nations. There are 9 Indian tribes in Oregon, and we have the blessing actually of engaging with them through this organization. If you think about the 3 different things that the division helps the university to do in terms of building community, there are 3 ways that I describe. First is incubate. Many of the policies and processes that we think about as sort of part and parcel of the university often begin in places like the Division of Equity and Inclusion. I'll give you 2 examples. The first is the common reading that the university is doing this year, and you'll learn more about that. I hope that you are able to attend convocation. It's open to the entire university community. But we incubated that through the Center for Multicultural Academic Excellence about 3 years ago. It was one of the first things that our unit provided funding for. And it's scaled up and now part of undergraduate studies. Another is a project that's focusing right now on policy development, and one particular issue is religious accommodations that we're doing and working with the Registrar's Office, academic affairs, student life, and other kinds of entities. So incubation. Connection. The CBA, for faculty, the union, provides an opportunity for all faculty to document their contributions to equity, inclusion, and diversity. And we provide, in connection with and in partnership with academic affairs, a host of development opportunities and resources related to that. The third is development. And so for all staff, there are opportunities to engage in professional development skills. And we partner with human resources, particularly Pam Farmer's office, in providing a way of incorporating equity, inclusion, and diversity skills into all aspects of supervisor training, as well as providing an opportunity for standalone training around issues of equity, inclusion, and diversity. As I conclude, I welcome you to the University of Oregon's community and really encourage you to see yourself as an active member in maintaining that community that exists today, but also in helping us to create a better community. Thank you so much.
Can everybody hear me if I just stand up and shout a little bit? It just causes me too much cognitive dissonance to hear my own voice on a microphone when I'm trying to talk to all y'all. How many of you come from environments where you've been exposed to an ombuds program? Or are you familiar with an ombuds program? Great, a few hands. Actually, an ombuds program is now in use in higher education around this country in about 300 different colleges and universities. It's used in about 60 or 70 major corporations and about 20 worldwide global corporations. And what an ombuds is it's a little bit different and distinguishable from the other programs you've heard of. Under Title IX, for example, most of the folks in the room are considered responsible employees, which means that if you have information around that relates to a sexual harassment situation or a sexual assault situation, you're required to report that to somebody, HR or to Penny Doherty or one of these offices here and they'll follow a process to put to resolve those situations. Ombuds is a little different. I don't know if it's appropriate to say that we are the opposite of a responsible employee, because that would mean I'm irresponsible. But I'm not considered a responsible employee, which means that when you work with the ombuds person, you have the option of working with a neutral, independent, informal, confidential resource that is not required to report anything short of things that are required under the law, statutorily required, such as child abuse or elder abuse, or things that create an imminent risk of serious harm. So the other difference between the programs here and perhaps the Ombuds program is that these programs all do something. I don't really do anything. So I'm irresponsible and I don't do anything. But what that really means is that when you come to the Ombuds program, it's a visitor-centered, visitor-focused program. So the principal onus for resolving any concern that you bring to an Ombuds program still resides with you. I'm a resource to be a confidential, safe sounding board, to discuss your concern, to suggest referrals to other programs. We have a resource book that's available to you. There's some copies out there. There's 43 different resources identified in here, a one-page description of the service, how to track them down, and who your points of contact are. But when you come to me, it's similar to wandering around an airport and finally finding that information kiosk. You know, you might be wanting to report a suspicious bag, you might be wanting to just know where you catch taxis. Any question you have, that information kiosk will handle. Ombuds is very similar to that. To use another metaphor, if the different offices up here in terms of the campus community are organs of the community, Ombuds is more like the collagen that's throughout the organ of the community. We pretty much exist to help you find anything or everything that you might need as a campus resource. We work with you directly and informally. We help service your questions around other resources, and we can help design strategies for working with you in individual challenging situations. We also do group work, so if you encounter a group dynamic that is problematic, we'll work with that organizational situation to help resolve those conflicts. But the difference is, we're an outcome-driven function. We're not a process-driven function. So basically, the tool that works will be the tool that we'll help you use. So I'm looking forward to working with you all. If you have any questions, we're right in the Lilith building over on west end of campus. The one with the big O. You'll get used to that big O. Welcome to University of Oregon. And any questions you have, we're a resource to get you channeled to any place you need to be. Thank you.
So now that you've heard from us, we would like to invite you to take 5 minutes at your table to talk about community, and most particularly, are there some gaps in terms of what you feel you might need in terms of developing and supporting community? Take about 5 minutes to think about that. We're not going to have time for every table to report out, but we'd like to invite at least, you know, a couple of tables to kind of share with us what their thoughts were, and know that we would welcome that input and thoughts. So if any of you don't have a chance to report out, but you have something you want us to hear, contact us while you're having that conversation. We know you've been sitting a while, and you know lunch is almost here, but not quite. So we're going to be coming around, giving you a little bit of sustenance while you have that conversation. So go 5 minutes, talk about community and any gaps or ideas and suggestions. Hello, folks. Could I have your attention? I'm hearing a lot of good dialogue and discussion out there, which is exactly what we were hoping for.
We are also, however, trying to be respectful of your time, and there are there's another presentation before you actually get to take a break for your lunch. So we want to kind of wrap up, and can I maybe just ask Bruce to call on a table at random to share what your thoughts are.
Okay, what are your thoughts?
Anybody want to stand up and volunteer what their thoughts, questions were?
Any observations about questions you have about the matrix of services, any observations about the campus community so far in terms of where you might want to explore more deeply into the program? Anything like that? So, please.
Hand over here.
Yes. I hope this doesn't reflect poorly on our table, but we have a lot of more questions about things that happen outside of the classroom, like what support for childcare, support for spouses getting to know each other, or work-life balance, those sorts of things. We kind of
wonder. The larger
community. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of resources available through the Human Resources Office. Regarding, there are three childcare centers on campus. There's a number of resources available to help find childcare, school information, things like that. So I would encourage you to either find me and I can help direct you, or just contact the Human Resources Office directly and we can provide those resources to you. It's a great question. Thanks for asking.
And thank you for the very positive observation here. And please, I guess I would say as we close and finish ours, if this is a more positive community than some of you have come from, it is because we have so much engagement and we have fellowship, not just sharing space. And to continue to build that and preserve it and make it an even better place does really require active engagement of all of our members. So we welcome you to this community and we really look forward to your engaging as members of this new community. So thank you so very much for your time. Privilege to be here.
Thank you.
I don't know if I'm working here. I continue to be impressed with who I get to work with day to day. It's a real blessing. Thank you. Was there a question? Sorry, we'll try. That's a great suggestion. That for those who didn't hear, I think everybody did, but a sense of how these pieces work together. I think we're going to take note of that, and I mentioned we're going to have additional orientation sessions throughout the year. That could be a really topic for us to explore further, I think. Thank you. So moving into our final session titled Labor Relations, I want to tell you that the University of Oregon is by and large an organized campus. If you haven't been here long enough to appreciate the humor in that one, you'll figure it out eventually. But, but I use the word organized in the labor sense, a unionized campus. If you're new to an organized environment, you may or may not notice some differences in how things happen here. If you come from a complicated organized structure, you may also notice some differences. Our structure is relatively simple, I think. I have the pleasure of introducing you to Bill Brady, who's the Senior Director for Employee and Labor Relations, who's going to kick off the session, and he in turn will introduce the representatives of the three major unions that we have represented here on campus. Bill.
Thank you, Ken. So
So good morning, everyone. To those of you who are new to the campus, welcome to the University of Oregon. For those of you new to Oregon, welcome to Oregon. I actually moved out here about 16 months ago from Minnesota. So for those of you who are from the Midwest, New England, or the upper Midwest, come find me and we can joke about how people in Eugene treat snow, because it's hilarious. So it's kind of bizarre. It's like mass panic. The apocalypse is coming if there's a snowflake. It's awesome. So I just wanted to share with you, I am the Senior Director for Employee and Labor Relations. My office is housed in Human Resources. We are a unit of Human Resources, and we are in charge of essentially maintaining our relationships with our various different labor organizations and employee groups. We enforce the contracts, we negotiate the collective bargaining agreements on behalf of the university, and we essentially engage in all different levels. For those of you who are in the room going to be supervisors, we can be your best friend, because you will read the collective bargaining agreement and you will get to page 75 and you will be like, I have no idea what it's saying. Contact us. We are here to help supervisors to try to figure out how to navigate issues surrounding the workforce and what are the rules that are applicable to employees, what are the rules that are provided for in the collective bargaining agreement. We can assist you with that. On the Human Resources website, there is a training and development section that has a our online registration system called Making Tracks. We often have supervisory type courses that are in there. I would encourage you to look for those. We will be offering sometime in the near future a specific training directed at supervisors who are completely new to a unionized environment, because it is a very different environment to be in. And it's good to have some pointers in that regard. So we are successful at the University of Oregon because we have very strong collaborative partners with our unions. The unions and the administration work hand in hand to resolve problems. We want to be as collaborative as possible. So we're gonna talk to some of the union folks today. We have an array of union leadership here to kind of introduce their specific organization. As Ken said, we are mostly unionized. So we have, if you exclude our hourly student employees, we have roughly 7,000 employees, and all but about 1,400 are unionized. So it is a very unionized campus. So I'd like to introduce first Theodora Coe-Thompson, who is the president of SEIU, Service Employees International Union.
Is it afternoon? No, not yet. Okay. Good morning, for as long as it remains. So let me begin. I'm Theodora Coe-Thompson, president. This is a new role, president of SEIU International, sub-local 085 here at the University of Oregon. I'm a 20-year employee. I work at the Office of Admissions with all those applications that come in. I've been doing that all these years. I'm also a proud duck. I am my undergraduate degree is from the College of, I mean from the School of Journalism, and my master's is from College of Education. So as president of the local here, I represent 1,700 employees here, the ones who prep this room for the catering, the food that you will receive, and everything else that makes this university run. So welcome to campus. As an organization statewide, SEIU 503 represents 55,000 public workers, care providers, and nonprofit organization employees in Oregon. Our mission statement is, we envision a just and vibrant society where everyone is treated with dignity and respect, and where all workers can provide for themselves and their families. Weekends without work, paid vacation, Family Medical Leave Act, Occupational Safety and Health Act, OSHA, the 40-hour work week. These are just a few examples of what the common good benefits that you, I, our families benefit. And so I wear proudly carrying on the stewardship of what the labor movement has brought for us. So we continue our work to defend our voice, the good jobs, and a fair pay for working families. And that's what this button is all about. Here at the University of Oregon, classified employees are vital members of the campus community. While our work defines us in the services we provide, we do the work to generate and maintain power, heat, and water systems, answer the telephones, and perform administrative support processes, clean classrooms, dorms, and offices, prepare and serve food to our students, process the payroll and financial aid payments, make sure that our contractors and vendors get paid on time, clear the leaves and ice from the sidewalks, and a range of other tasks that keep our campus running smoothly. For many of us, the University of Oregon is more than a place where we work. At the years of service reception events, from the testimony of classified employees who have reached the milestones of 5, 10, 15, 20, 25, and more than 30 years of service, it is at these events that classified employees share their stories of being part of the University of Oregon. It's about family. The love for the work we do with dignity and pride in serving students and the campus community. And that there is as well the pride that comes with loved ones, children, and grandchildren who are students and alumni of the University of Oregon. Thanksgiving's around the corner. We will soon be having lunch. So I'll briefly say, tack for Morten. Thank you for the food. This was something I learned and appreciated when I was in Sweden years ago. To thank the person or the people who did the work for the meal you received. In like vein, I look forward to hearing from classified employees I represent of their being included to serve on search committees and on university committees, respect for their interest to training and educational opportunities that they seek, and that demonstrates respect for all that they do. So we all work together in common interests for a respectful, safe, healthy, and welcoming environments for, you know, for all of us in our community to be a great place to work. Thank you, and welcome to the University of Oregon.
Thank you, Theodora. I'd like to welcome Eleanor Wakefield up to the podium. She is the Vice President for Grievances for the Graduate Teaching Fellows Federation.
Hi, everyone. Thank you for having me here today. I appreciate the opportunity to introduce the Graduate Teaching Fellows Federation, or GTFF. As Bill told you, my name is Eleanor Wakefield, and I'm the Vice President of Grievances, and I'm also a PhD candidate in the English department. Our president, Shauna Meehan, couldn't be here today because she's pursuing her research abroad. In our dual roles of students and employees, you'll interact with all of us, usually in both of those contexts. I'd like to introduce our union and say a few words about how our role as campus workers might affect you while you're here at Oregon. The Graduate Teaching Fellows Federation, which is affiliated under our parent union, AFT Oregon, is made up of nearly 1,500 graduate student teachers, researchers, and administrative workers all over campus. GTFs are teaching and research assistants, lab supervisors, office workers, instructors of record, tutors, and more. We've consistently had between 70 and 80% full union membership throughout our four decades of existence, showing that GTFs are very proud to take part. 70% is a relatively high percentage for full membership in a union, for those of you who don't have a union background. We employ two staff people, but all of the board positions are held by graduate students who volunteer their time to support their colleagues. Many of the graduate students who are GTFs on this campus spend a lot of their time supporting their peers through union volunteer work. GTF efforts have earned us tuition waivers, caps on fees, the administration of our own health insurance, summer tuition waivers, a fund to offset health and parental leave costs, and much more. Incoming GTFs often report that our excellent health coverage and other benefits are major factors in their recruitment. We also have worked hard to improve the quality of funding of higher education in Oregon through our efforts to lobby state legislators in Salem. We are excited to partner with our colleagues in SEIU, United Academics, and the UO administration to continue this important effort, which will benefit all of us. As a GTFF board member, I encourage you to talk to your department stewards for United Academics and look into signing up for full membership. I had a whole section on why you should do this, but Michael's going to do it for you in a second. So it's really helpful for us as your employees or people working under you or with you, if you also know how the union works, both of our unions, and we just love working with UA members, so definitely go do that. And they can also help clarify things. A lot of the grievances we get are just misunderstandings of policies on both ends. So always feel welcome to come talk to me. I'm the grievances person, so talk to me. Or Michael or your department stewards about how can I improve anything that might not seem like it's working right. So depending on your role on campus, you might encourage GTFs in various roles. As I said before, GTFs work as tutors, TAs, graders, lab assistants, lab supervisors, private instructors, office workers, and instructors of record, and probably more. GTF stands for Graduate Teaching Fellow, but obviously not everyone who is a GTF is teaching. It's possible that our title might change. I don't know if I told Bill we might talk about that. Because of our varied roles, a key component of good working relationships in all of these capacities is good communication. We train our members in establishing professional, open relationships with their supervisors, and we also encourage our members to talk amongst themselves to troubleshoot potential problems. We hope that when GTFs bring you feedback, it's helpful and clear. One major thing you can do if you supervise or otherwise interact with GTFs is to encourage them and your department to use workload allocation forms. You guys might not have heard about these. I hope you hear about them a lot. They're super important. It's how we track our hours. The grad school website can tell you more about the breakdown of different GTF appointments and how many hours those include. A typical GTF appointment is a 0.49 FTE, and that's about 19 and a half hours of work per week. So these workload allocation forms allow us all to see, is this work fitting into that 19 and a half hours a week? And flexing is allowed. It's totally possible that more of those hours will come at midterm and finals. That's okay. But one of our goals is that if a GTF isn't able to complete their work in the FTE allotted, you guys together can go over that form and see maybe there are problems. Maybe the GTF can be more efficient. Maybe in the past, other people have fitted in. But maybe when you go over past workload allocation forms, you'll find, oh, this is a job that just doesn't fit in this allotment. So that's our goal with those forms. And you can help us and you by using those. So like I said, I'm the grievances person. When we talk, I hope that it's always not stressful, informal, easy to solve any communication problems that might lead someone to think we're having an issue. My dream is that we never have to talk at all. But when we do, I hope that it feels really collaborative and not scary for either the GTF who brought me a problem or for any of you guys. So I hope that that's all you ever have to hear from me. All of us here at the University of Oregon are excited to have you in our departments and classrooms. We love working with new faculty. We often find them inspiring as we ourselves go on the job market, and we often find that new faculty are really excited to collaborate with us and bring exciting new ideas to our departments. So we're thrilled that you guys are here and hope that all of our working relationships are really positive this school year. Thanks.
Thank you, Eleanor. Now I'd like to introduce the president of United Academics. United Academics represents our faculty here, and it is a very wide group of faculty. So for those of you who are coming from other institutions, our faculty union covers everything from postdocs to researchers to teaching faculty and everything in between. So I'd like to introduce Michael Dreiling, president of UA.
Thank you, Bill. It is indeed an eclectic bunch that United Academics represents. I'm a faculty member in the Department of Sociology. I'm taking on a second term here as president of United Academics. And I gotta just look at this event already and just note the difference from what I experienced when I first arrived here, and I gotta applaud everybody who's helped put this on, academic affairs, HR, and everybody who's pulled this together, this orientation event for faculty and officers of administration. So thank you for making an information-rich as well as a community kind of oriented orientation possible for folks. Thank you. On the issue of United Academics is the newest union here on the University of Oregon campus, representing about 1,800 faculty. If you are a new faculty member here, a non-tenure track faculty, instructional, research, postdoc, librarian, tenure track faculty member, can I see a show of hands, just see who's faculty in this crowd? Okay, yeah, so yeah, good three quarters or more of you here. Our new faculty here, welcome. And the others here as officers of administration, I assume you're also getting a lot out of this orientation. And the three unions that are up here representing faculty, classified staff, as well as graduate student employees, you know, you'll have opportunities to work with them in different capacities. These unions are collective bargaining agreements, as Bill was saying. Supervisory roles really do kind of put a different responsibility on members of a unit. Let me now say a little bit more about United Academics and for the faculty here involved. As a new union, I'm delighted to say that we just, I think, negotiated a historic second contract. Bill Brady over here, yes, is very, very, very welcoming achievement, I think, both for the University of Oregon as well as for all faculty here at the university. And this will be a three-year contract that will cover faculty. And it's something, when I told some colleagues elsewhere, I had some colleagues from the University of Washington contact me about this, and they said, you know, so what's the biggest thing that you got out of this new contract with the University of Oregon? I said, well, I think the most surprising thing is that we're actually going to have 5 years of raises in a row. And they said, well, we've had 5 years of no raises. I said, yeah, that's been our experience as well. Very sporadic. So stability has been a big improvement as a result of working with the university administration to really, really begin to make sense of the budget, make sense of how to invest in faculty, because investing in faculty is investing in the academic mission. And I got to say that our work at the table, solving problems, as Bill Brady said, has produced significant results. It's not just in salary, it's not just in benefits. It's really about changing the conversation on the campus. It's really about setting our sights on our academic role as faculty members and the mission that we serve. So I'm just thrilled about what we've been able to accomplish in the few short years we've been a union. And one of the other elements that I can speak to is Senior Vice Provost over here, Doug Blandy. I fused you both, didn't I? Doug Blandy is has been working with the chairman, the chair of our Committee on Diversity and Equity, Dan Hosang, who's back here in the room over here, and is I'm happy to say that we have a mentoring program that will be a nice pilot for all tenure-related faculty, all new tenure-related faculty, to really work with professional development, professional resilience, really support for academic research. And we're, as a union, happy to be kind of putting this out front as a way to support the academic role that faculty play at the University of Oregon. And the union is also going to be initiating various professional development projects to support non-tenure faculty, so instructional, research, postdocs, and librarians. And so I'm hoping you'll keep your ears open and your eyes peeled so that when news of this comes and an email from Professor Dan Hosang over here comes to you, that you'll consider signing up for this important new pilot project working with academic affairs. And so it's just it's really something to note, and I think it's going to really move faculty forward and move our university forward. The other thing I want to mention here, in addition to that collaborative project with Academic Affairs, is tomorrow night, United Academics is hosting a meet and greet for faculty. And so we'd like anybody here to, if you can show up between 6 and 9, have a local craft beer or a local cider at the 16 Tons Cafe out on 29th and Willamette. There's food around, various cafes and restaurants. It's an open kind of plaza setting. So we're hoping to welcome you to the University of Oregon and have conversations and meet and greet kind of setting. So right now, colleagues here from the United Academics, as well as different departments, are going to pass out some information about United Academics. So for all of you who are faculty members, and I'm sorry for OAs, you're certainly welcome to take a packet here as well, but they'll be passing this out. So over here is Professor Karen McPherson, who's a faculty member in Romance Languages, and also our Vice President for Tenure Track Faculty Affairs at United Academics. And then we've got Heather Quarles, who's now our grievance officer for United Academics, also in Romance Languages. And then where's Chris Sinclair, who's, yes, there he is, who's also a professor in mathematics. And so he's also the chair of our communications and organizing and membership committee. So these are faculty who are elected to serve the union and the leadership of the union. Be available at dinner tonight as well. So if you'll be attending the dinner, feel free to have a conversation with one of us about United Academics or your department or just if your you know initial experience with the University of Oregon and ways that we can help. So with that, I want to just welcome you all and. Oh yes. Very good. So this postcard's this little. Just a little form like this. It's got a map, details on the meet and greet. And again, bring families. Yeah, this is really, it's really a very welcoming kind of plaza setting. I got to say, I'll be there with my youngest daughter, who's 7, and look forward to meeting with folks from various departments around campus. And also, the brochure that's in there, I got to say, kind of highlights the basic principles of United Academics, our mission, the summary of the contract, the recently negotiated contract. Those of you who are really interested in it, the union is a democratically operated organization, and we're constitutionally run a nonprofit organization, essentially. And the like all collective bargaining agreements, there's a ratification process, and members got to ratify this. And so we're about to have a general membership meeting on October 6th. I'll throw that out there as well, where members will vote on the ratification of this historic contract. And so that requires simply just signing a card to become a full voting member of the organization. You'll find a card to join the union just simply by signing that card, and we can answer any questions you might have about that, either at dinner or send me an email or any one of the elected leadership of United Academics, okay? So if anybody's got any quick questions, I think we'll wait till lunch. I'll hang around outside. And welcome to the University of Oregon, everybody. Thank you.
Thanks to all of you. See if I'm turned on here now. Before we break for lunch, I want to do a couple quick things. One is if you have arrived and have not yet signed in on a sign-in sheet on your table, please do so we know that you are here and can get in touch with you. We don't send spam. Second is, as you checked in, you picked up a bunch of stuff that you just dropped. One of these that has the schedule for today. It also has a lot of other kind of practical how-to information that you might find helpful if you're having trouble getting email or ID cards or keys or things like that. So feel free to refer to that little packet of information. I also want to give you a sense for this afternoon. I talked about last year's and previous orientations. The significant difference you have is that last year you would be 1/4 of your way through sessions like this and you'd be really dreading the rest of the next day and tomorrow. This is the end of formal sessions like this, but I want to urge you to come back for the afternoon sessions. which are going to be very different and I think more engaging and active, if you will. Starting with, first off, everything is going to be over in Knight Library. So across campus from here, it's a long ways from here, but we left a lot of time. So first time for lunch, which you'll get to as soon as I finish with you here now. But starting at 1 o'clock, we will have campus ambassadors leading campus tours. You won't get the whole tour because they're going to take relatively small groups in different directions, so they're not all talking over each other. So some of you will see different parts of campus than others. But take advantage of one of those tours. They'll meet up out in the lobby area here outside of or near the front doors, and they'll show you some of the interesting things, tell you some of the good stories about campus. Maybe you'll hear about Pioneer Mother and Father, for example. Again, those tours leave at 1 o'clock. They will drop you off at the library, so you don't have to find your way over there. Once you're at the library, there's kind of Dr. Seussian balloons. I think they're green balloons with gold stars, and I don't know if there's the Sneetches or the Snatches, but watch for those if you're having trouble finding your way around, and we'll have academic affairs folks situated as well to try to bring you from place to place. We have two simultaneous sessions, 1:45 to 2:30. If you can't decide which one you want to attend, don't worry, because after a 15-minute break, we will have the same two simultaneous sessions from 2:45 to 3:30. The expectation is you will then go to the other one. 120 of you, four or five presenters, it would be a lot easier for the presenters to go to the other one, but we want to give you the chance to explore different spaces in the library, and also some of our presenters need the resources in the rooms they're in. Then from 3:30 to 4, there will be information tables in the browsing room. You'll get to know the browsing room well through your years here, because that's where lots of workshops and things happen. These information tables range from parking to Many Nations Longhouse to the Center for Multicultural and Academic Excellence. Groups that you will find interesting, and if we could find the time and energy to have each of them come and present to you formally, it would be worthwhile. But instead, we're giving you the opportunity to take that time to pick and choose who you'll speak with. There also will be coffee and cookies there in case you need enticement beyond the information that's available. Then from 4 to 5, we will have informal affinity groups, three of them, one for tenure-related faculty, one for non-tenure-related, one for officers of administration. You're not required to attend any of this. We hope you'll be interested in attending, completely non-structured. We will have academic affairs folks and other folks in each of those three rooms and be prepared to respond to questions and comments. And if it's really quiet, we'll probably have some leading comments to get things started. But generally, it's a very nice conversation. Then at 5:30, please be back here. Bring your families and friends. If you'd like, social time starts at 5:30. We'll have age-appropriate refreshments. And then starting at 6 o'clock, I'll introduce the provost, Scott Coltrane, assuming he gets back to town in time. And he'll give you some remarks. And then we'll have dinner and meet the special guest. I'm not supposed to say who, and have a nice evening. So now lunch is ready, I believe, and please enjoy the rest of the day.